Okay, great. So our last panel for today, by the way, I want to make a small correction. So Houghton's conference is not in this room because there's a renovation going on. So it will be on the second floor, the big Mukov Theater, which is a very nice room. It's actually quite big. But I didn't choose that room because there's no natural light like this one. And also here you have a better view. I don't know whether you have a chance to walk outside. It's beautiful. But Houghton's conference on Saturday morning, starting at 9:30, is on the second floor. Is this first floor or second floor of the moot court room? I think it's the first floor, huh? Second floor? Okay, whatever, you can find it, okay? And so this is the last session on AI and ethics compliance, which is also a key aspect of AI regulation and governance. We will discuss China's existing ethics review system and also the firm's efforts to improve compliance. We are very fortunate to have four distinguished guests with us for this panel. 首先有请段伟文，首先是段伟文老师，他是我们在这个科技伦理方面也是一个权威的泰斗的人物，他现在是中国社会科学院哲学所科技哲学研究室的主任教授，中国科协复旦大学科技伦理。 和人类未来研究院的特聘教授，只要说到中国的科技伦理，肯定有段老师在呢。所以今天呢，特别荣幸段老师能够参与我们的这个讨论。坐在我旁边的呢是曹建峰，他是曹总呢是腾讯研究院的高级研究员。我记得您还写过很多这方面的文章。我其实是先看了文章再找到您的，是慕名而来。 然后呢，长期的从事互联网前沿的技术和数字经济相关的政策、法律和社会伦理研究，就是我在邀请，因为我们其实花了很多时间准备这个会，我们其实是从暑假的时候开始准备的，每一个嘉宾我都会先看了你的东西，然后觉得你特别棒，然后才来的。我的 inner，然后我才邀请的。On my right hand side is Natalie. Samuha, she's a very young but a rising star in this area. She's now teaching at KU Leuven Faculty of Law in Belgium. She has been deeply involved in formulating AI policy in the EU. And actually, I think you're one of the earliest, members. You used to work for the European Commission, and you are one of the earliest members of the team that draft some of the earliest AI ethics regulation. So I really look forward to hearing your stories, your insider aspect, perspective, what's happening in Europe. And on my far right is Marcelo Thompson, is actually my colleague, who's now teaching at University of Hong Kong. And Marcelo is very interested in law and technology and very active in this field. And his research focuses on the intersection between law, political theory, and technological change. It was great to have my colleague on this panel. Okay, 那我们首先呢，就是先问段老师吧。段老师，您觉得就是说，在生成式人工智能的研发和运行之中，产生的主要的是什么样子的伦理的风险？然后，当然，伦理的风险很广啊。 这个包罗万象的，这哪些方面的风险是最引起中国的关注？然后，这个学界、企业，还有就是主管的部门，他们会不会关注的点不一样？可能段老师要按一下再重。好，这个生成式人工智能的话呢，它因为正像前面的讨论一样，就是在中国。 把它纳入监管或者是法律的这个规制以及伦理呢，它实际上这个里面有很多交叉的这样一个部分，而且呢，就是其实以前在中国的这种对于科技的这种监管或者是法规里边，它是很少谈到伦理的，只是在2019年，也就是在基因编辑事件之后，就是。 关于这个科技的这样一个主流的这样一个政策的这种叙事里面，相关的文件里面，都把那些个因为前沿的新兴的这样一些个科技，对整个社会
造成了一种颠覆性的影响，所以呢，就把那些个可能一下子还没办法从现有的法律啊对它进行一种规制的啊这样一些个风险啊，当然除了安全风险之外，把它这个纳入到这样一个伦理的这样一个风险这个里面来。所以这样来把这个背景讲清楚以后呢，我们再来看不同的主体对于这样一个生成式人工智能的风险或者是伦理风险的这样一个关注呢，它其实也在很大程度上也是跟监管或者是法规的这个关注点是有相当大的重合度的。为什么这么讲呢？因为我们讲这个伦理的时候，很多的时候是讲的这种人和机器的关系啊人和这个自然的关系啊等等等这些。但事实上呢，我们这里更多的还是安全风险。这个安全风险核心的就是内容安全。那么这个内容安全呢，它其实也有一个路径依赖。从这个前年的深度合成到后面的这个AIGC 再到这个 GAI 等等等等这些，所以因为我们相关的这种监管或者是法规的这个权威的部门他们可能更关注的是内容的安全，也包括社会动员力的这些安全。但是从我们学术界来讲的话，我们可能关注的点会更深入一点比方说 ChatGPT 它是一种内容的生成，那么这就相当于是我们以往是在现实世界中生活，那么互联网给了我们一个数据的这样一个世界，而现在它是一个生成的这样一个空间，而生成的这个空间里面它谈到的伦理它有更多的这种人文的这样一个思考，比方说 ChatGPT 或者是大模型会不会成为一种知识的权威，会不会成为一种精神的权威等等等等这些，再就是它会不会成为我们人类的行为的指导。当然这有很多这些学术问题有很多要深入探讨的，但是我认为在当下ChatGPT 它真正的伦理问题也包括在学术科学研究里面这些伦理问题，很重要的一点还是合成数据的问题。因为ChatGPT 生成式 AI 它不是一个简单的生成式的人工智能，它不是从无到有的，它是对现有的数据的一种合成。那么这种合成的数据它其实已经不再是造不造假，真不真实，客不客观，它是一个新的一种存在的方式也好，或者是商业运作的这样一个基础也好。所以在这种情况下最近国际货币基金组织关于金融科技的伦理的风险里面就谈到了合成数据，就是说合成的数据它实际上在很多情况下可以用来矫正现有的那些数据的代表性不足，或者是有偏差，或者是有偏见等等等这样一些问题。我先就讲那么多。
谢谢段老师啊。那我再问一下建锋啊。生成式人工智能的这个暂行规定里面呢，也有在伦理方面提出了一些要求。那具体是什么样的要求，然后你们企业合规是怎么落实这些要求的？因为我感觉好像说的也是法律说的很笼统，对吧？没有具体一些细化的准则。
对，好的，谢谢胡岳老师邀请。对，其实今天包括上午吧，下午其实大家讨论这个监管生成人工智能管理办法很多这个很多点内容安全啊，对吧？隐私呀、数据啊，其实都讨论的差不多。那其实这个法律更多还是从这个监管，包括大家讲的一些安全审查的角度，它其实对于伦理其实就大概只有一句话，就说你这个大模型要去遵循这个社会的这个伦理的这个道德。那所以我更多的这个从这个价值对齐的角度吧，就是我们怎么去把伦理的这个以前大家讲的很多伦理的一些抽象的这个要求啊原则啊，对吧？但这个很多它很难去落到这个基础实践上去。就现在有了这个生成人工智能之后，它的这个价值对齐的问题，说你让它跟人的这个需求价值，对吧，能够去相一致。那这个其实我简单解释一下，比如它这个是涉及三个层面的问题嘛，一个就是说你怎么去让它满足这个使用者的这个需求，比如说我这个使用者可能是个医生，对吧？我医生我希望他提供的这个专业的这个医学的这个知识不会去这个幻觉，对吧？如果我是一个律师，我不希望他援引一些错误的或者这个他编造的一些这个案例。那如果我可能是一个科幻作家的话，那我更多希望他有一些这个幻觉，对吧？天马行空的一些想象。所以这个其实是他最根本的怎么去满足这个不同的用户的这个需求。那这个其实是一个这个 contextual awareness， 就基于这个特定的场景，不同的用户还有不同的需求。那这个是最基本的这个对齐的维度。那第二个维度其实更多说 我们怎么让这个模型不作恶，或者模型不被滥用？其实为什么大家会更多就是他不会做一些被社会不允许的一些事情？因为以前其实你作恶是有成本的，你需要有专业的这个技能、专业的这个知识，对吧？那大模型是降低了这一块，就是说你去滥用技术的这个技能，对吧？你要去编造做一些这个网络的一些病毒的这个攻击的软件，或者用它去传播一些虚假的信息，或者制作一些这个武器，对吧？就这样一些滥用行为，以前是有门槛的，但大模型才能把它门槛降低了。你怎么让大模型去不做这样一些社会不允许的一些事情？那这个其实是第二个层次。那第三个层就是我们怎么去，那可能是更遥远的，就是未来整个人类的层面，这个模型它会不会失控，对吧？会不会产生一些这个生存性的一些风险？那就是我觉得现在其实我们行业还是从这个前两个维度，就怎么去满足用户的需求，同时确保模型不会作恶。那这个其实在整个的这个AI 的这个大模型的生命周期里面，大家都有一些这个相应的一些这个措施。比如说，首先它这个训练数据，对吧？对于预训练数据的这个干预，要去移除一些恶意的呀，对吧？色情的呀，或者一些这个违法违规的一些内容，或者构建一些价值对齐的一些专门的一些数据集，那通过数据质量的把控，能够去让模型未来的这个输出符合这个一定的这个价值或者伦理的这个需求。那在这个预训练的阶段，其实现在采用的更多的是这个人类反馈的强化学习，或者说一些原则性的 AI，通过这个人类的这个一些这个专门构建的这些对齐的数据，让它能够举一反三的去学会人的这个需求跟这个偏好。那这个训练完成之后的一些，你比如说这个。就训练之后，在部署之前的一些安全的措施，比如说国内更多讲的是这个蓝军的这个测试，对吧？比如一个红军，一个蓝军的相互去对抗，找到这个模型的这个漏洞。国外可能讲的是这个红队的这个测试。那另外还有像这个可解释的一些 AI 的方法，能够去对模型的输出做一定的这个解释。那此外的话，可能还有一些外部的一些对齐的工具，你比如说对于这个。上午徐科老师问的，可能问张胡跃教授的那些信息，他其实可以通过检索的方式，对吧？去外网去检索，比如说百度啊、谷歌呀，通过这种方式也可以实现一些外部的一些对齐。那这些领域确实有很多的这个进展，但其实这个技术攻防嘛，你可以防守，但也有很多这种这种魔高一尺道高一丈，对吧？也有很多这种越狱的一些方法，或者一些投毒的一些多种的一些这个对抗的一些措施，它也在进化。所以这整体来说，它应该是一个不断的去进化的这样一个发展的这样一个领域。
很好，我想就是接着再问一下段老师，就这个问题啊，就是刚才建峰也提到了，他们企业做了一些这个措施了，那他们在研发之中，他们是具体是怎么样展开这个人机对齐的这方面的工作的，然后遇到什么样的困难和挑战？
大概它就是说，所谓的人机对齐嘛，人机对齐其实我自己的感觉是，我们都还没想好，但是这个技术呢发展得太快了，因为为什么这么讲？因为人类的价值都很难对齐，对吧？那不要说人机对齐了，所以现在这个大模型它所产生的，我们就好像100年前这个统计学导致的这个人是一个平均人一样的，这个生成式的大模型它所产生的是一种平均的人类的表达内容，或者是平均的人类的这种能力，那么我们从认知的角度来讲，如果你的这个内容的生成全部都是没有任何的价值冲突的，我很难想象这样的内容是能够有创新性的。所以我说的意思就是说，人机对齐这个事情本身，也是对这个前提也要再思考。但是呢，就是正是因为在这样的困惑之下，因为又有了这样一个迫切的治理或者是监管的这个需要，因为这个大模型的能力实在太强了，所以呢，就要对它做一些个工作。但做的这些工作呢，大概都是会采取一些个问答的方式啊，它有一些个问答题，或者是有些问题它回避啊，或者是有些问题呢，它可以看看它是不是做出了恰当的回应，然后再通过这种强化学习啊等等这些方式来改进它，大概会这样。但是这个里面从原则上来讲，就是因为年初的时候，上面有很多的这种咨询，就是希望我们专家做一些咨询。但是我当时就说了两点，第一点就是我们这个生成式人工智能，它是一种思维技术， 是一种涌现出来的思维技术，因为当你这个参数达到一定量以后，它就涌现出来一个超强的这种能力。另外一个呢，就是人机对齐，它是一个工程，就说它是用工程的办法，就是技术加人，技术加人的这样一个力量。那么你在对齐的这个过程中，你的这样一个监管也好，伦理的规制也好，法律的这个合规也好，这跟你的语词有关，就说你对生成的内容，你的包容度有多大啊？你对它的这样一个这种导致这种价值冲突的这样一个敏感性的这个张力，你能够接受多少？那么还有一个，你进行这样一种对齐所要的成本是多少？所以，所以我们在这里面就是讲的，就是第一个就是前提实际上还没想好，第二个呢就是这样一种活动本身它的这样一种成本，实际上也是会跟这个创新的这个效率之间有一个张力，这是我大概是这样一个设想，但是呢，就是我们为什么又能够这样做呢？因为它已经工程化了，工程化了，就像航天工程，它可以用可靠性工程保证火箭的发射是成功的。但是你这个航天工程，你保证它的这个火箭发射成功，那么你在可靠性这个工程上，你投入是多少？这个也是跟航天的成本、工程的成本是有关系的。当然，这样其实也就意味着，它能够在美国实现政治正确，那么同样的，在中国也可以，在其他的国家也是可以实现政治正确的，这是没有问题的。所以我们现在的问题就是说，它带来的是一种颠覆性的变化，但是呢，我们还没有想好，反正这是我的一个基本的这样一个认知。
好，谢谢段老师啊。Let me come back to Europe, Natalie. Either correct me if I'm wrong, right? I mean, Europe is now drafting the AI Act. But the origin, if we go back to the genesis of the AI regulation, does it start in 2018, where the European Commission introduced the ethic guidelines for trustworthy AI? Did you get involved in that? In drafting that document, tell us about the history. What were the controversies that led to this development?
So basically, in 2018, the European Commission noticed that it was behind on China and the US, in its own words, on AI. And so it decided to come up with a strategy on artificial intelligence for Europe. And as part of that strategy, so there were three pillars. One was boosting the development of AI, one was looking at the socioeconomic consequences, so the impact on labor. And the third one was ethics and law. But the focus was on ethics because 2018 is also the year that the GDPR came into force. So at the time, nobody wanted to think of introducing new legislation if you just had the GDPR. Everyone assumed the GDPR is so comprehensive and is already heavy enough that it should also do the trick for AI systems because most AI systems, in any case, process personal data. So instead, the European Commission mandated an expert group of engineers, ethicists, companies, civil society organizations to come together and to draft ethics guidelines. And the idea was that guidelines would be more than enough. We have the GDPR, we have other binding legislation, but companies need some sort of guidance on what does it mean to be ethical in the context of AI. And so at the time, I coordinated the expert group. So I had the task.
Which department were you working
So that was in DG Connect.
DG Connect.
DG Connect, which is also the pen holder for the AI Act. So it all started there. So that's a DG that is responsible for communication and also AI. And so this task meant that 52 experts, and it's called a high-level expert group, so that means they had high egos, which was a lot of fun to work with, had to come up with a sort of document on ethics. And just to give you context, it took us longer to not come up with a definition of AI than to come up with ethics guidelines for AI, because everything was questioned. So it was hard work, but then after a year, we came up with these ethics guidelines. But as an expert group, it was specifically said that these guidelines are not sufficient. So we did see that there are very probable legal gaps, that the GDPR is not going to be able to provide protection in all kinds of situations. And the guidelines also start from the idea that in Europe, we have this three constitutional values, human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. And we saw that with AI systems, there might be a risk. Now, all of that story is, of course, before generative AI. And this is a conference on generative AI. So as part of the question, you could say, you know, how can these guidelines be then relevant for what we see today? Well, these guidelines try to take a broad approach. So AI was defined very broadly. And we came up with like seven requirements that AI providers should implement in order to make their systems more trustworthy. Trustworthy meaning ethical, legal, but also robust from a technical perspective. You can read the guidelines if you want. I'm not going to name all these principles here. And probably it's the same principles that every country in the world agrees on a high level basis. But these guidelines were then a basis to draft the AI Act, because when even the experts that were tasked to write ethics guidelines were telling the commission, well, you also need something binding, that's when the commission said, together with scandals that we then saw in the news on AI systems creating harm to human rights, for instance, the commission said, okay, we want to create something binding and we would like to be the first ones to do it, because as they saw with the GDPR, being a sort of standard setter can also have its advantages. And so that's how we came up to, just a week ago, a political agreement on the AI Act.
Right. And Natalie, I want to take this opportunity to ask you about your summer school, the AI summer school you're running. Do you want to take this opportunity to promote your summer school?
Sure.
Tell us about that.
Sure. Yeah. So every year in Leuven, KU Leuven University, I organize a summer school on the law, ethics, and policy of AI. It's very intense. It's a week and a half. And we see basically every legal topic, AI in competition law, AI in human rights law, AI in IP, and also AI in education, AI in healthcare, so in many sectoral systems. And it's a mix of law students, but also philosophy students, engineering students. So it's very multidisciplinary. You do group work together to learn to speak each other's language, because we do speak different languages. And then you go home and you have a network of brilliant people all over the world.
We should bring your experts to Hong Kong. And then we do a joint project here, a joint program, because you see the huge demand here. Yeah, I mean, this is a great initiative. Okay, where am I? Totally forgot. I'm so entrepreneurial that I forgot my main business task. Okay, so 我那个段老师来，我下面问一个问题是问您的，其实中国在生成式人工智能出现之前，很早就已经开始了这个科技的伦理的治理的体制。 能不能够给我们简单介绍一下主要的发展的节点，还有这个政策的法规，然后这些文件对于生成式的人工智能的科技伦理产生什么样的影响？因为我知道中国呢，在这方面呢也是多个部门推动嘛，然后那这种多头治理的架构呢，其实好不好？你觉得？
嗯，就九龙治水啊，好像一般不是特别好。对这个。 我先讲一下我们这一波的这个科技伦理的，它实际上，最早是2017年啊，因为更早的追溯，那就是上个世纪的这个多利扬啊，这个深蓝战胜卡萨帕罗夫啊，这个，然后再后面，20这个世纪的前面10年大概会讲，干细胞啊，或者是等等这些，但是这一波是2017年，2017年这个时候人工智能。 这个深度学习出来以后呢，首先是IEEE 他们从这个标准化的角度，大概是有一个关于这样一个自动化或者是智能系统的这样一个伦理标准，他们想到中国来推，推完了以后呢，当然中国的相关的工信部的相关的这样一个研究机构也跟他们有一些合作，有一些讨论。 那么这个时候呢，企业包括腾讯啊，包括有些企业，包括后面的这个旷视啊、商汤啊，他们也是因为各种原因啊，就是搞了这个人工智能的这样一个伦理的讨论，或者是制定了一些个标准。 但是真正的推动国家层面的科技伦理的这个治理呢，是2018年底的这个基因编辑事件啊，这个大家都知道，我不详细说了。但在这个之后的话呢，当时的这样一个从国家的层面来讲，认为这个事件的性质非常恶劣，因为它突破了这样一个伦理的底线或者红线，这就意味着全世界都有那样一些个狂人科学家，他们始终是想打破这样一个伦理的这个底线的，有这样一个欲望，有个冲动。那么在这种，这是一方面，另外一方面就是它实际上在一定程度上破坏了中国科学和中国科学家的在国际上的这样一个形象。这样的话呢，就在国际上就会认为中国是一种类似于野蛮的西部的这样一种野蛮的东方，所以在这里面当然也会有伦理倾销的这样一些个说法啊。实际上就是包括基因编辑事件，它是背后也有美国的相关的科学家对这个是一个暧昧的态度，他们就希望在中国这地方可能伦理监管比较松的地方来做这个事情，然后他们就可以怎么样，那个具体不说，不详说，这个所谓伦理倾销。所以转年到2019年、2020年，就是国家层面就成立了国家科技伦理委员会，以及国家科技伦理委员会到2020年就成立了国家科技伦理委员会的三个峰会，就包括人工智能，包括医学，包括生命科学。所以这个时候我们去看后面的文件，它实际上都是有这个重点领域啊，它成立了这个委员会。我觉得这个是一个重要的一个节点，就是三个委员会的国家科技伦理委员会的成立。那么在这个同时2019年，就在疫情前一年，已经在讨论中国科学家的科技伦理守准则。那么这个内容就是体现到我们后面的这个中办和国办发的这个关于加强科技伦理这个治理的意见还是建议啊。那么这个我们就知道它不是一个主管部门，也不是九龙治水啊，而是由中办和国办来发出来的。那么它发出来以后，它就意味着它是一个政治性的或者是政策性的一个文件，不是一个简单的一个科技领域的这样一个文件。那么当然在这个同时，在 AI 领域，我们说实际上在19年那个时候，18年19年那个时候，他们已经在做一些个，因为人工智能是由科技部的这样一个战略师下面，他们搞了一个新一代人工智能这样一个发展的这样一个办公室，所以在这个办公室下，他们成立了一个新一代人工智能的治理的这样一个委员会或者怎么样也好。那么他们当时就推出了这个发展负责任人工智能的这样一种新一代人工智能的治理原则。那么在其后一年可能在2020年还是2019年，他们又颁布了这个伦理规范。但是同时呢，在网信和网安这一块，网信这边我就不说了，算法备案什么这些，但是其实在网安协会那个，他们也在之前也颁布过这样一个人工智能的这样一个安全标准啊等等等等这些。那么在这个人工智能的这个安全标准或者是伦理规范这个里面，它其实也体现了就是我们在前期的一些讨论的一个重要的跟其他国家不一样的地方，就是它特别强调对于不同主体的规则比方说在网安学会的那个关于 AI 的这样一个规范的标准里面，它就有比方说使用者呀这样一个部署者呀研发者呀等等这些。那么在这个科技部的这个新一代人工智能的那样一个伦理规范里面，还有增加管理者什么什么，这它这个要求是不一样的，所以这个实际上也是一个方面。那么所以我刚才讲到了，就是一个是国家科技伦理委员会，然后是两办的这个关于加强科技伦理治理意见，然后呢在这个之前我讲的 AI 的这个伦理和治理规范这一块呢，它可能更多的是科技部他们制定了一个新一代的这样一个治理原则和伦理规范。但是呢产业部门这边工信部这边，他们除了早期进行了一些标准研究，但是标准研究发布的比较迟，是今年大概3、4月份才发布出来的，就是人工智能的这个伦理标准啊。那么这些工作呢，其实也都是法律的人都参加了，比方说人民大学的郭瑞啊，就参与到了这个工信部这个标准的这样一个相关的制定。同时呢，我们还可以看到，就是工信部还做了很多事情，信通院做了大量的工作，包括跟企业包括像京东这样一些企业一起来这种研究可信的这样一个人 AI。那么这个实际上就表明在我们中国的这样一个治理的它的这样一个策略是一种三明治的策略，
它是国家那个主管机关和部门，再就是相关的智库啊，再就是企业，那么实际上就是前期都参与到里边来，那么这也就是为相当于是为将来我们这个科技伦理治理它是可预期的治理打下了一定的基础，就是我们开始的时候相关主体都介入到里面去了，他了解这个相关的这样一个政策制定或者是他的这样一个流程，所以最后这个法规出来以后呢，它实际上已经有一种预期，就是我企业对这个相关的问题伦理分析它有一个预期啊，这是我这样就讲了，应该这一块是发展的比较快的。然后在后面呢就讲了最后下面一个点呢，就是我就简单点，就是伦理审查这一块。伦理审查这一块呢，因为在中国和全世界都是生物医学领域是比较领先的，所以在这个之前，今年四月份还是什么时候，这个卫健委和科技部他们就发布了这样一个生命医学的这样一个伦理审查的这样一些个标准，对吧？也发布了这个，包括这个呢，但是这个参与这个审查的这样一些个文件的，其实是跟这个后来颁布的科技伦理，最近颁布的九月份颁布科技伦理审查办法，他们的这样一个团队是有一定的重合性的。所以你可以看到呢，有些内容是比较接近的，或者说至少是相互参考的啊，这是这个。那么在这个过程中呢，其实就这个伦理审查办法里面就体现了我们这几年的这样一个一些个具体的发展啊，一个呢就是大量的这样一个伦理审查呀，因为最近有些，而且有些大学已经不是说都成立了伦理委员会，但他们遇到一个问题，也包括就是医学领域遇到的问题，就是伦理审查量太大。然后呢，伦理审查委员会忙不过来，没有那么多去审查，所以他就流于形式。另外就是研究人员他们认为你这个审查是给我这个制造障碍阻阻的这样一个发展，但是不管怎么样，医学领域还算是做的比较好的。这是所以这次的伦理审查办法里面有一个叫简化的程序啊。那么另外第二点呢，就是在这次的这个疫情流行期间有大量的应急的研究，所以呢在这个疫情期间我们还专门讨论了有关疫情的这样一种科研的这种应急的办法，应急的审查应该遵守一些什么规则，所以这次在伦理审查办法里面也体现出来了啊，这是第二个。第三个呢，就是这一次伦理审查还有一个叫做复核机制，专家复核机制。那么这个专家复核机制是从哪里来的，就是我们刚才讲的三个委员会，人工智能啊，生命和医学伦理委员会，他们这几年做的一个最主要的工作，就是制定了科技伦理领域的高风险的清单。那么这个高风险清单就是都是一些专家研制出来的啊，就是有一些详细的这样一个规定。那么这个规定呢，后面你仔细去看，在生命伦理审查办法里面还叫高风险清单，但是在这次这个伦理审查办法里面，它改了一下，叫专家复核清单，这个意思是一样的啊。这次这个附录里面的那几条那个内容，其实就是三个委员会里面的提出来的那些高风险清单里面那些比较有代表性的那样一些共识性的这样一些个内容。我大概就讲这么多。当然后面还有最后补充一点啊，最近正在筹备建立中国科技伦理研究科技伦理学会。这是因为国家科技伦理委员会它在一定意义上呢，它是一个政府的跟政府相关的这个机构。那么在最开始它成立的时候是属于国务院的办事机构。那现在呢它就是已经把它要转移到科技委下面的这样一个研究机构，它现在性质变了，它以前是一个国务院的办事协调机构，现在国家科技伦理委员会是一个协调，是一个学术研究的这样一个机构，这个相关的报告里面大家都可以看到。但是无论怎么样讲，这个呢它还是具有一定的官方的性质，所以相关的委员当他们在回答社会的一些咨询的时候呢，他不知道该不该亮出这个身份，因为你亮出这个身份好像你是代表国家，但是学者他就更多是代表自己的意见。所以鉴于这样一种情况，就是说从国家层面，现在就是从中国科协正在推动中国科技伦理学会，而且是国家一级学会。这个工作就是意味着就是我们要鼓励各个领域开相关的这样一个研究啊，包括刚才跟曹老师跟曹建峰还有包括很多企业，他们也是讲现在是不是企业也应该有相关的这样一个参与进来。这个现在正在这个筹备之中，而且很快可能会成立啊。
对，段老师干货满满， 我回头还得再问你啊。我先要问我的同事啊。Marcelo, let me bring you out to talk about the United States. If we look at what's happening in the U.S. at the moment, I mean, many areas, I mean, there's a very active plaintiff's bar in the U.S. and then there's some litigation going on in relation to ethics issues, discrimination. Seems like a very big problem in the U.S. and at the state level, there have been many states that are introducing relevant laws. Tell us, you know what the latest development in the U.S. in this regard. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Angela, for having me. Thank you all for being here. Angela gave me a homework, which is to explain in some level of detail what's going on in the U.S., encompassing relevant cases and legislative developments at the state level, and also what's going on at the federal level. And I'll try to brush through this homework quick so that I can have can raise a bigger question towards the end of my intervention, which I think would be fitting for a panel on ethics, and I think an interesting question for us to engage on in relation to the matter. So, well, we have several examples of situations where ethical issues emerge in relation to AI in the US. I think the most famous example is COMPASS, right? The recidivism application that is used by the justice system and that is proven to be extremely biased, discriminatory. From this more ostensible way in which AI is used together with the criminal justice system, we have a range of concerns emerging with more tacit uses in which discrimination is taking place through the use, for instance, of generative technologies in relation to images, Stable Diffusion, the way this is increasingly being relied on by the advertising industry, by applications, by Adobe, NVIDIA, and the way this is biased, rely on biased data sets as well to create an environment which is populated by images, which represent paradigms, for instance, where all judges, all CEOs, all people who are portrayed as highly skilled workers are generally white, are generally male, and where work forms of work which are associated with lower paying jobs are represented massively by people of color, by women, by racial minorities. And this is the concern with how this may create a dystopian future and a self-reinforcing process in which what is represented in society is what is depicted in the systems like that. And that, of course, has a perpetuating self-perpetuating effect. So these are just some examples that have been shown. There is a study by the National Institute of Standardization and Technology, the NIST in the US, showing how facial recognition technologies, they are largely biased as well. False positives for people of color are largely disproportionate in relation to for white people. Now, there have been, as a response to these concerns, a series of legislative developments at the state level, and we have had laws in many different states. The first one was the a law in Illinois in relation to interviewing for in the context of employment. Requiring that the use of AI be notified. In California, you have rules against the use of AI in terms of spamming people or influencing election, privacy, different privacy frameworks in different states which are emerging, like the CCPA in California, proposed privacy legislation in New York containing rules on AI. And there are some proposed rules on generative AI. So, for instance, in California, the proposed AI, AIware Act that would require any state agency using generative AI to disclose to the person that the communication is through the through generative AI. So you have a series of legislation, legislative initiatives in place in the US, some states where there are already state laws dealing with several different aspects of ethics, right? But at the federal level, and that's what I wanted to get to then raise a more general provocation. So there was first in 2022, a blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights, covering several aspects of AI concerns, from safety, algorithmic discrimination protections, data privacy, right? And this is very interesting since 2022, because in 2012, in the US, we had the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights, which was proposed, which was put forward by the Obama administration, right? And 10 years have passed, and there is no federal data protection regime in the US. In fact, there is very little in place at the federal level in the US relating to all aspects of data governance, and AI being just one instance of that, being just one example of that. And we have a very different situation, a very different landscape at the federal level between the EU, between the mainland, and in the US. There has been an absence of piecemeal development in terms of legislation of different aspects concerning the public interest, of different aspects concerning all aspects that are of concern in other jurisdictions in Europe, in China, and in the US, they are not tackled at the federal level. Of course, you have a lot of legislation at the state level, and you have a difference in terms of attributions between states and the federal government. But what materializes now, the latest reaction in the US at the federal level is the executive order that has been issued by the Biden administration. And the executive order is a very interesting document because it's a clearly reactive document, and it's really clearly reacting to concerns above all of national security. If you do a word map of the executive order in the US, it's very interesting to realize that whereas the word security appears 126 times in the document, the word liberties appears 7, and the word freedom appears 9. And it's very interesting to see that the sorts of concerns that are materialized, they are materialized in an existential sense, in a moment where there are concerns which are existential in relation to AI, in relation to the generative potentials of AI, in relation to founding models, in relation to forms of threats of a national security kind in terms of critical of AI as a critical and emerging technology, which is typically a language that is utilized in a national security kind of discourse. And it's in this context that finally, at last, there is an attempt to regulate technological challenges in the US that make it very challenging on the other hand, to put these things into place, because it might be a bit too much and too late. The idea that these rules are going to be made concrete, it's very unlikely. They are likely to have an effect at the federal government level, but it's very unlikely that we are going to see something emerging from there in relation to platforms, in relation to the developers of AI systems, and that we're going to have concrete legislation, for instance, in terms of privacy, right? Of data privacy, which we haven't seen so far, right? So what is the indication that we're going to have this developing concretely? There are some concrete obligations which are important in the US that have been put in place by the executive order, for instance, requiring the developers of the most powerful AI systems share their safety test results and other critical information with the US government, which was a very strong assertion of power in relation to the major developers of AI systems. But other than that, it's very difficult to envision the ways in which, in relation to the private sector, this framework is going to develop to address the whole range of issues that we see being addressed, for instance, in the EU, where a much wider range of public interest concerns are being reflected right, in the AI Act, as they have been reflected in the Digital Services Act. But I'm happy to, if we have time, to come back to that later on, because I think we're already short and we need to open for questions.
Okay, great. Great. Thank you, Marcelo. Yeah. We will have questions for you later. 让我再回来问一下建锋吧。我刚才听了这个段老师介绍了他给我们勾勒了一个很好的一个框架，但是我说句实话，我觉得这东西比较虚。就是说有很多的委员会，然后治理，还有现在有学会然后有这个办法，然后这个那个，好像没有一个是强制性的。对吧，好像还是靠你企业自身的去合规，对吧？我就想看听听从企业的角度，你们现在是怎么去就处理这方面的实践的问题。
对，我觉得您这个是一个特别好的这个问题，就是现在因为科技伦理吧是一个很大的一个概念，就是 very broad and very vague， 有很多其实它就会涉及到我们其实现在在国内已经有很多这个立法，数据个人信息保护法，还有这个数据安全法、网络安全法，还有现在对于这个深度合成啊，甚至是 AI 的很多这个规范，就其实很多的这个伦理的问题已经通过这些具体的一些立法在合规当中已经解决了。那我们是不是在思考说，哎，到底哪些问题属于这个科技伦理的这个专有的范畴，说法律解决不了的，对吧？或者比如说一些前瞻性的，比如说是不是说对于就业的问题啊，对于人际关系啊，或者对于一些未知的一些风险，对吧？那这个其实是一个可能未来我们再去做这一块要去考虑的一个问题，就是到底哪些问题是真的需要这个 soft 这个 approach 的科技伦理，更多的是一种软性的这个治理的这个方式来去解决的。那其实刚刚段老师讲了很多这个既有的一些经验，我觉得其实我们对于人工智能技术来说，人工智能确实今天讨论，我感觉一个词就是最近有个概念的这个 EACC， 对吧？这个有效加速轨，就人工智能确实是非常的这个进化，非常快速的去发展，就我们以前的所谓的这个伦理的一些规范，它更多是 reactive， 更多是被动式的。那我觉得随着人工智能发展，你要构建怎么一种主动式的 adaptive 的这样一种 approach， 对吧？那包括这个科技伦理委员会，其实确实有很多企业国内外大家都在做，但是确实没有看到说，哎，哪一个企业它披露出来说，我这个科技伦理委员会确实在这里面已经实实在在 effective 的去发挥一些作用。我觉得这个确实是存在一些这个问题，所以大家其实未来到底这个人工智能领域的这个，对吧，科技伦理审查也好，或者科技伦理委员会也好，它的这个人员或者专业性，对吧，它的这个它这个功能确实需要更多的这个学术界的这个探讨跟这个思考。但是我就回到我刚才讲的这个 adaptive 这个 approach， 我觉得其实是未来其实我们要去从这个被动式，像这个 adaptive， 就是这个叫什么来着，叫主动式的或者适应性的这样一个方向去发展。我觉得是有我们最近的其实三个概念，一个就是说叫做这个AI ethics by design， 就伦理治理设计的，包括我刚才讲的这个价值对齐 value alignment， 它其实就是一个把这些抽象的这个伦理原则转变为刚才段老师讲的一个工程化的技术化的一个实践，让这些原则能内化于这个系统本身。这个我觉得是一个我们最近在思考的一个思路。那另外一个思路在想就其实是 AI ethics service 或者 AI ethics answer service， 对吧？因为大家互联网都在讲这个 SaaS 呀或者 LaaS 呀，对吧，很多用通过服务的方式，那这个就用中就是说伦理治理的服务嘛。其实就未来怎么去构建一些第三方的这样一个服务的市场，其实大家有很多的思考，包括当然讲的这个 IEEE 的呀，还有我们在做的一些这个工具啊，或者一些这个第三方的服务，它是通过这样一个市场化的一个方式来去解决里面的一些问题。那可能还有一个概念，其实我自己在想的就是 crowdsourcing of AI ethics， 就伦理治理的这个众包化。其实很多的网络安全领域的很多的问题，它就是包括蓝军也好，或者一些这个白帽黑客也好，它是构建了一个这个很广泛的一个安全的一个社区。那是不是伦理的这个治理，它未来要去不断适应，对吧？也得有一个类似的一个这样一个这个这样一个社区，它通过一些这个漏洞的挖掘啊，或者一些挑战的一些项目，让大家更多的这个社会的力量参与到这样一个工程里面来。我觉得可能是未来就是说从这个 reactive 到这个 adaptive 去可以考虑的一些这个思路。
非常好，段老师，我刚才听您的这个评论的时候呢，有您提到的几个事情啊，就是第一个就是这个认证的事情， 对，您提到了好像是信通院现在有一个可信AI 认证，好像他们做了很多企业，
做了很多
做了
类似的工作，
能讲一下就是说因为我也自己也看了一下他的这个认证的这些项目啊，好像就不是特别清楚他具体是做点什么，就是对，尤其是对生成式人工智能的话，他的这个认证
生成式人工智能还没有，它是前面的，
它是前面的。
生成式人工智能他们这次参与了这个支撑了这次乌镇的互联网大会，世界互联网大会的那个发布的那个文件，负责任的什么生成式人工智能那个文件，他也找了行业也找了专家，反正我也介入到这个里面参加过。
对，因为他这个是跟那个一个协会一起就是人工智能的一个很大的一个叫什么名字，
对，那个叫中国人工智能产业联盟。
对，
那其实是信通院牵头建了一个产业联盟，所以它其实是构建了一个它就 Trustworthy 可信 AI 的一套这个测评的体系。
对，就这个问题我就是想回到段老师，就是说我感觉就是说总体来说中国的这个科技伦理审查还是相对是比较软吧，对吧？那以后未来您是不是觉得可能是会通过第三方的认证啊，然后这些方法是能够形成机制化的系统化的这样子去规制，这方面是不是就是我们的未来的前景？
这个我首先讲一个文化上的差异或者是背景，因为在中国呢所有的规范它是在文化里面带有一定惩罚性的，就是说你如果不遵守我这个规范，那你就要受到惩罚。所以在这个情况下呢，大家从潜意识里面他不会特别主动的去做这个伦理的，就是把这个伦理规范把它实施啊或者什么，他不会主动去做。这个呢就跟这个英美不一样，因为欧洲是有另外一个，欧洲它有基本权利作为它的这个 foundation。那么英美呢它是一个风险偏好型的这样一种创新性的这种国家。所以呢他们的做法是他要制定一个路，制定完了以后呢他就可以去做。那么一个典型的例子就是在2018-2019年的时候，美国来了好多人，包括当时的这个 partner 什么 AI 到了中国来，就问很多专家说你们对这个人工智能军备竞赛怎么看啊，就问这个问题。当然我们当时回答就是说那这个我们可能要搞嘛，然后搞完以后我们再来谈判嘛，大概这个意思啊，就是我不能落后啊。但这个是官方的这个表达，并不，其实并我们自己也搞不清楚是怎么回事。但是后来你看到了那一年的年底，美国国防部就制定了 AI 的这样一个伦理原则，他意思就是说我只要遵守这个原则我就可以做。实际上也就回到了曹建峰刚才讲的就是要主动适应的这样一种发展。其实在美国的相关的像生命伦理很多领域的也有一个声音，就是说你要制定伦理规则，你制定了伦理规则以后我们才能够去抓住这个创新的机遇。而且它的一个辩护是这样的，就是说你比方你这个如果我们没有规则我们就不能做，不能做的话呢很可能很多科技上比方说对于医疗啊一些好处啊，可能就有些患者就一下享受不到，对吧，等等这些。实际上就是说伦理如果我们从文化上把它作为一个不仅是主动适应，而且不仅是一个所谓的刹车或者是一个软着陆的这样一个机制，还会把它作为一个科技本身它的一个内在的需求。因为在 AI 这一波的 AI 的时候，实际上麦肯锡还是他们有做了一个报告，其实就是全世界很多公司很多企业的高管都主动要求监管，就像这次 OpenAI 这个是一样的。当然这个里面它实际上是多个主体有不同层面的视角，那么它实际上也像100年前镀金时代的那些石油大亨烟草大亨他们主动去要求监管那个时候是一样的，意思就是说我现在的能力非常强，你要监管我。但实际上它也就因为当你监管不是很到位的时候，那你还是要知道我是一个很强大的力量。当然另外这种EAC 什么这么有效加速主义呢，这个它实际上是一种加州的那种意识形态，它是觉得加速发展科技是最道德的，你们现在阻碍它是 最不道德的。所以再回到这个软法和这个所谓的硬法，实际上也就是说大家都会认为中国好像是一个大一统的国家，其实不是这样的。 其实中国它很多的部门它都是有一种条块的这样一个关系，比方说科技部，你们都会认为它是管创新的吗？不是啊，科技部从一开始它就不是管创新的投资的，所有的大型的科技创新的投资都是由财政部和发改委来支撑的。科技部它你看到现在它不是变成一个科技委下面的一个部门了吗？所以这里面所以这个里面来讲，就是如果不管它软还是硬，其实就是要跟各个部门的功能结合起来。比方说工信部为什么要搞这些最佳实践，它就是要推动产业发展，其实就是这个意思嘛，就是说我们公众也好，政府也好，这个企业也好，都有一种伦理的焦虑。那么这个伦理的焦虑它不是一个简单的画一个边界画一个红线，因为那个东西它并没有一个固定的边界和红线。就像我们讲2050就一定要这个碳中和，这个本身就不是，从科学上来讲它就不是一个严格的一个结论，但是它表明了我们的一个承诺一个态度。所以现在就是说我们现在做的这些工作好像从某种角度来说比较虚，但是要知道在2017年或者是2019年以前，在我们的相关的科技的这样一个政策法规里面根本就没有这个词，就我们现在至少是有这样一个观念，所以这个就是本身就是一个很大的进步。所以它在很大的意义程度上它是一种承诺，就是我们包括企业要制定一些伦理规范，它也是一个承诺，但这个承诺怎么把它落实力，当然包括这个我们现在制定的这些伦理规则跟国际上的这个伦理规则都是一样的，就是找了很多人，大家这个先找一些人来做研究，做完研究以后用德尔菲法请很多人来访谈啊，然后大家都觉得都是这样，所以最后得到的是一个平均的智慧，就是相关领域的人对这个东西的一个共识。那么这种共识它只能作为一个工作的假设，它不可能作为一个说完全的就你可以照它去履行的。所以我觉得不管是软还是硬，我们这个还是刚开始，这是第一。第二的话就是如果它进一步能够跟不同政府部门的功能结合起来，真正的是成为科技创新的一部分，就像讲创新有一个零到一的这个过程，但是伦理它其实也是有一个零到一的过程，因为伦理的问题它和创新本身就是矛盾的。比方说我关注过这个金融科技领域，那金融科技领域你不用大数据可能吗？你必须要用大数据，但是你只要用大数据它就要侵犯到个人的隐私，所以这个里面怎么去平衡，我觉得这个至少我们现在有了这样一个观念以后，所以它至少它作为一个背景，它就会往那个方向去推动。
行，万事开头难，我想问你一句，你很快可以回答我吗？你们有没有被就要求被监管？
因为其实很多这个监管的这个立法，就是它也在跟踪嘛，就都在制定，对，所以
就你想想，在美国。他们有这个有多少家公司啊，十几家吧，就是去年今年对吧，他们就是十几家公司就是 make voluntary commitment 啊，我们就是我们要做这个做这个做这个，对，在中国没有对吧，
中国其实也是有的，它有这种行业的这个自律规范或者自律公约，那这个其实像你刚才讲的那个中国人工智能产业联盟，他们其实在也发过一些比如说生成人工智能的一些自律规范，包括刚才他讲的乌镇的那个报告，其实这个也是有很多行业的规范嘛，就这个也是就是比如说信通院牵头的这个他会拉上企业大家做一个自律公约，那类似这个其实也是存在
的，但你没有至于跑到科技部去说啊监管我是吧，没有还没去到那一步啊，
因为我们没有那个表演的舞台
OK。So we have a bit of time left. I really want to bring back Natalie because, you know, as you mentioned, that the EU AI Act is very close to finalization. How does the EU plan to tackle the ethics problem? This seems to be highly controversial in Europe at the moment. Yeah, tell us more.
So when it comes to all AI systems have risks.Like all technology has risks. So it's a matter of how much risk you're willing to accept as a society and which kind of risks you're willing to accept. And I would say that the majority of risks that we see with AI and with generative AI are not fundamentally new, right? So privacy concerns, concerns around bias, concerns around lack of transparency, risk of discrimination, the human tendency to overly rely on technology. That's part of all AI systems. And people often tell me, well, human beings are biased too, so why are you talking so much about bias in AI? And that's of course true as well. But the difference would be the scale, I would say, right? So the scale of the automation makes things worse. However, when it comes to generative AI, I do think that there are some more unique risks because they have the ability to mimic in a very realistic fashion human language, speech, voice, images, and art, as we discussed earlier today. And this brings ethical risks when we don't know that AI systems are being used, that something was done by generative AI, but there are also ethical risks when we do know that it comes from generative AI. So just to give an example, because these are the things that are keeping us busy, the first risk when we don't know that AI is used, think about impersonation, right? So fraud can be committed, or think about, let's say there are elections and there is a video released by the number one politician that will be probably voted. If that's a deep fake video and the person says horrible things, by the time it was proven that it was a fake video, elections are over and it will have influenced the results possibly for the next 4 or 5 years. So that is something that will, for instance, be tackled by the AI Act, at least in theory. But there are also risks when we know.
How? What specific measures does the AI Act?
So for that particular example, when something is generated by a generative AI technology, there needs to be a sort of watermark or transparency indication. So transparency is often the key to the AI Act. But then there are all these risks when we know that AI systems are being used. Think, for instance, of chatbots. There are chatbots nowadays that pretend that they're your best friend, and they can also emotionally manipulate you. I know I'm interacting with a chatbot. I don't think it's someone else. But how do we deal with this emotional attachment? How about people who missed a loved one that is deceased, and they create a sort of chatbot based on the voice or the text of the deceased person to keep them artificially alive? Or think of the fact that nowadays students, when they write an essay, are allowed to use generative AI. But it's not exactly the same when you yourself need to think, for instance, about writing about the Holocaust and what are the problems with that versus having an AI system generate it. Because when we delegate our language, we actually are delegating our thoughts.
Right. I mean, I think that we at this point understand the ethical concern, but it's more about how EU plan to tackle this. Do you see something similar as what the Chinese does? Have these committee, ethical review committee, or does it mostly rely on the enterprise compliance? Or
so I think this is maybe a good moment, because this is a panel of ethics and compliance, to distinguish both. So I think the things I raise, there are a lot of ethical questions. And there is no black or white answer. And the AI Act is a piece, is a regulatory tool, a piece of regulation, compliance. So that will be enforced on companies. And it addresses some of the ethical concerns, but not all. Because in order to address or govern ethical concerns, you first need to have a moral stance on where you want to go. And then you can regulate it, which the AI Act does. So it imposes mandatory requirements on high-risk systems. But on some things, like the emotional manipulation of chatbots or the example of the deceased, we don't really have a moral stance yet. It still needs to be discussed. And so that's where ethics as a discipline still needs to come in.
Fascinating. So do I understand correctly that even under EU AI Act, it's for the most part rely on companies' self-compliance?
So companies have to mandatorily, so it's binding regulation, they need to abide by certain rules. There are also prohibitions, and there are significant fines if they don't comply with it. But you're right with the self-regulation in the sense that they themselves need to assess whether their systems comply with the AI Act. And only exposed after the systems were put on the market, someone can file a complaint. And then they will be investigated, but not upfront.
Right. I mean, tomorrow we will have the
the panel on the global trend of AI regulation, we will delve more deeply into these questions. And because AI Act is like really important document, everybody is watching it, China is watching it very closely, and we definitely need to understand it more. We are running out of time, but I want my my colleague Marcelo to have the last word. I mean, what is your overall perspective on the AI and ethics governance problem? I mean, what do you think will be a viable solution to deal with this? Do you think of the certification regime, would it make sense, or what do you think?
Well, I think the model being put forward by the EU is certainly a very interesting one, right? Where you have a division between systems that pose higher risk and systems that pose less risk, and a different kind of obligation and auditing and compliance that is imposed to higher risk systems. And I think that is the way forward. And what I find very interesting in Natalie's remarks just now is the moral component, right? The moral part of our ethics concerns here. As we approach issues of ethics, it may seem that we're approaching these issues as procedural requirements, right? For companies to be ethical in terms of how they develop, just in terms of following certain procedures, but there is a deeper component there in these procedures, which is at time a moral component. There are moral elements which are embedded in these in these questions. So this exposes the differences between the regimes in a very stark way, in a very pronounced way. If we compare, for instance, China with the US, the moral dimension is a remarkably different one. Whereas in China, you would have, for instance, in the recent standards that have been put forward by the TC 260 different stages of the life cycle of an AI system, a different moral concerns being instantiated there. For instance, the idea that the socialist core values need to be respected, need to be reflected there in the way a language model is going to interact with you. That in the US would be unthinkable, that you're going to have this kind of moral concerns. But then for the EU, and that's the interesting question, how do you deal with the moral element, isn't it? It's fascinating because we see the EU actually coming ever closer to China in the sense of reflecting a moral dimension as well in the way the system is developing, but at the same time, right, being hesitant to admit that, like we have our core European values, like the rule of law. And it's very interesting. What is the rule of law in this context, right? What is the rule of law? In China, the rule of law is one of the socialist core values. It's one of them. There are other values like harmony, civility. There are other socialist core values, right? And what is very interesting is to see that the rule of law in China then is one value that is balanced together with others. And when we come to Western liberal societies, we have the idea that the rule of law is kind of an overarching ideal. But what the rule of law entails is that we are not going to engage with the moral dimension, that courts are not going to make moral decisions. They are going to focus on the letter of the law. They're going to be applying the law. And as we turn to AI systems, that could also appear to be the case. But then we have issues like societal harm, which is something that you find in the Digital Services Act, and you find in the AI Act as well. The idea of harms which have a societal dimension, that go beyond individualistic concerns that are represented by an idea of rule of law and reflect a moral, a societal dimension in the development of these systems. And in this way, we see the EU system coming closer to the Chinese system in how it engages with these issues. And the question is, how is the US going to enter this debate? How is the US going to engage with these bigger, with these deeper ethical questions? And more importantly, with the role that the government can play or should play in relation to these questions. Because when you have that embedded in a large language model, a large language model as something which is deeply moral, which is moral true, and through their moral reflections that are there embedded in the system, how can you regulate that? How can the state regulate that without itself deciding on the propriety of this moral dimension which is embedded in the system? And I think that is the biggest question, how that will be for in terms of development in the US, how the US is going to address these issues of societal harm, for instance, that the EU recognizes, right?
Great, fantastic. Okay. Sorry. I mean, good that you propose those unresolved challenges that which we will carry on the conversation tomorrow. But I would like to open up the floor for Q&A. We have about 5 minutes left. Yes, this gentleman at the back, would you like to introduce yourself and ask question? Ask a very short question.
Thank you. I'm Gabriel. I'm a research student in public policy back at HKUST. So I have a question about the Chinese AI ethics legislation. So as far as I understand, there are a little bit two parallel regulations forming, one under Ministry of Science and Technology about the ethics review measures, which also touch upon AI. And then there's the regulation of the Cyberspace Administration, so which are directly about generative AI. So my question is kind of, I guess, mostly for Mr. Cao, for enterprises, how do these two different tracks of regulation, like what is the different impact of them? Do they sort of complement each other or do they just exist in parallel? And which of them puts higher requirements on compliance or which one has the bigger impact on day-to-day operations of enterprises that work on generative AI? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. So I will give a brief answer. Maybe Professor Duan can make some comments later. So I think you raise a very important question currently for concerning the regulation of AI in China. So I think many of the regulations or provisions enacted by the CAC is not voluntary, so you have to comply with is your obligations. I think that's it.
Okay,
对，我觉得其实就是说，确实现在很多合规的吧，对吧？很多这个网信办的一些这个立法的要求，它确实是有更多的一些这个强制力吧，对吧？这个其实是一个很多就是大家在合规，其实上午也讲了很多了，包括一些这个备案等等很多一些操作。 但其实科技部的很多东西，其实像段老师讲的，这个很多还是在一个早的一个发展的一个阶段，可能很多是这种 voluntary 啊，或者一些这个一些补充性的，包括一些这个软法的一些这个标准啊，对吧？其实很多就是一些这个确实给行业提供一些更多的一些这个自律性的一些这个建议吧，因为它很多其实包括最近出台的这个科技伦理的这个审查的这个 办法，对吧？它的这个落地其实它更多是建立了一个水准，对吧？但是后续的其实很多的这个落地，它不存在一个这个 one size fits all 的这样一个方案，对吧？其实很多的这个在互联网啊或者在人工智能，其实很多行业的这个特殊性，所以它其实更多的还是依赖于未来，像大家讲它怎么去跟这个具体的这个监管的这个部门的一些工作去结合起来，对它未来的这个落地的这个细则是非常非常重要的。